So the next one is gluconeogenesis, because once you understand the basic concept about the gluconeogenesis, it's very easy to understand the gluconeogenesis. So what is gluconeogenesis? It's nothing but, so once the formation of glucose into glycogen means it is called as gluconeogenesis. The same things, same reaction is going to reverse. The breakdown of glycogen into glucose means it's called as gluconeogenesis process. This picture is an easy representation for the gluconeogenesis process. So we know that the glycogen is mostly stored in either in liver and muscle. So when we are under the starvation conditions, when our body needs more amount of glucose, that time the stored glycogen is going to deplete, is going to break down of small molecules of glucose. It can be utilized for energy production in both either muscle and various places. So the liver is having enormous amount of glycogen. We know that because it's around 8% of glycogen is stored in liver, but because of muscle mass, more quantity of glycogen is stored in skeletal muscles. When you are in starvation condition, the liver is having more amount of glycogen. The glycogen is going to break down into glucose. The same manner, the skeletal muscles also is having a glycogen. Same thing, the glycogen is going to convert into the glucose molecule for utilization for energy purpose. For the both the cases, for the conversion of glycogen into glucose, the important enzyme is responsible enzyme is glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. That enzyme is responsible for breakdown of glycogen into glucose phosphate, glucose molecules. It has been used for energy utilization purpose. You can see here, this is a simple diagrammatical representation. So once our body is having an enormous amount of glucose, means it's converted into the glucose 6-phosphate. From that, it's entered into the glycolysis cycles. That's one pathway. Glycolysis cycle, it's converted into the pyruvate, lactate, then its TCA cycle is going to, it's going to continue. Otherwise, the glucose is enter into the HMP pathway, it's going to oxidize. Otherwise, the glucose 6-phosphate, it's converted into the glucose 1-phosphate with the help of phosphoglucomutase enzyme for the production of glycogen. So the glucose 6-phosphate is converted into the glucose 1-phosphate, then is going to form a glucose UDP molecule, then with the primer, then it's going to form a glycogen. It is called as gluconeogenesis process. So this is one cycle. It's going to formation of a reservoir. So when your body needs glucose, that time the stored glycogen is going to break down. It's going to break down into glucose molecule. That process is called as gluconeogenesis. So you always, we can see know that the both the step, gluconeogenesis and the gluconeogenesis, it must be the close resemble pathway. Yeah, you can see here, this is exactly gluconeogenesis pathway diagram here. So the glycogen is degradation into glucose in terms of gluconeogenesis. So the glycogen is going to break down into glucose. So for those things, it's act as some independent set of enzymes. It may present on the cytosol to carry out the unique pathway, the genolysis, gluconeogenesis pathway. So the glycogen degradation breaking into alpha-1,4 linkage and alpha-1,4-1,6 glycosidic bonds. So we know that during gluconeogenesis process, these are the third step and fourth step is very important, because the chain elongation is going to happen with 1,4 linkage. Sub branch is going to happen with 1,6 linkage. So the same manner, the breakage, depletion of the same glycogen is going to happen on the same place. Either it is going to cutting into sub branch, means it's going to cut the 1,6 bonds. Otherwise, single molecule means it's going to break down into 1,4 linkage. The same thing is going to reverse. You can see here this diagrammatical representation. So in gluconeogenesis, it consists of four steps. Genolysis process, gluconeogenesis, it consists of three steps. The first one is action on glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. The second one is debranching enzyme. The third one is glucose 6-phosphate to glucose molecule. You can see here, So we have seen in last glycogenesis process, this is the last step. So it's having a long linear chain and various sub chains are there. So the sub chains are, it's arranged in 1,6 bond. So the linear chains are bond with 1,4 bond, alpha 1,4 bonds. So the glycogenolysis is consist of three steps. First one is action on glycogen phosphorylase. Then second one is debranching. The third one is glucose 6-phosphate to glucose conversion. So this is the overall both glycogenesis and glycogenolysis pathway. So you can see here, this is a glycogen. Glucose molecule is continuously is going to arrange together. Glucose molecule is converted into the UDP glucose. That glucose is going to attach with uridine diphosphates. So it's going to attach with the primer. So you just imagine this is a primer, glycogen primer, otherwise a glycogenin. So this UDP molecule is going to cleave this, exactly this glucose molecule is going to attach with the non-reducing part. So the continuous attachment of this glucose molecule, the chain is going to elongate. So finally is going to become a long linear chains. Then it's split into two chains. Then it's going to attach with the various sub branches. Then it's become a condensed glycogen. In glycogenolysis process, the glycogen is going to break down. You can see here this picture. Here you just imagine this is a long chain of glycogen. So it's going to split into single molecule. It's called as a debranching process, because we know that the glycogen is having a various sub branches. So the debranching is going to happen. Then it's split into the single glucose molecule. So this process is called as glycogenolysis process. We already know that the glycogenolysis process is divided into three important steps. The first step is action on glycogen phosphorylation enzymes. So you can see here. So the glycogen, it's having a non-reducing N, alpha 1,4 glycosidic bond will be formed. In genolysis process, the first step is going to cleave the same bond, alpha 1,4 glycosidic bonds are, it's sequentially cleaved with the help of enzyme glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. So that enzyme is responsible for breakdown of 1,4 linkage, glycosidic linkage bond. So you can see here, so this is a long chain. So the glycogen phosphorylase is going to cleave the exactly the 1,4 alpha 1,4 glycosidic linkage. So it's going to split the 1/1 glucose molecule until it's available of four molecules, until available of four molecules in either side, either any side. So this is the first step, action of glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. What is the role? The glycogen phosphorylase is going to cut down the glucose by to cleave the alpha 1,4 glycosidic bond in the linear chain. So 1/1 the glucose molecule is going to cleave until the four glucose molecule is going to remain in any of the side. Okay, this is a first step. The glycogen is going to form, it's known as limit dextrin. Okay, so when it comes to the four glucosan is going to remain, it's called as limit dextrin. That means it can't further degrade by the phosphorylase enzyme. Once it comes to the limit dextrin stage, the phosphorylase enzyme, glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, can't able to split the further glucose molecules. So the second step is action of debranching. So once the limit dextrin is formed, that means it's remaining of four glucose molecule, the branches of glycogens are cleaved by two enzymes. So the next one is the branches. You can see here this branches is going to leave. So here the branches is going to cleaved by two different enzymes. It's called as debranching enzyme. It's having a bifunctional enzyme. It's called as bifunctional enzyme. So it's acting on through two steps, step one and step two. So what the thing is there, the transferase enzymes, okay, debranching enzyme, the transferase enzyme, it's going to remove the fragment of 3 or 4 glucose residues in the branch and transfer them into other chain. So you can see here, so this is a limited dextrins, it's having a sub branch here. So the transferase enzyme is going to transfer the glucose group from the 1,6 bond to another chain, but it's going to leave the one glucose molecule. So one glucose molecule is going to leave remain, so the remaining molecule is going to remove, then it is attached into the another chain. In step 2, the amylo alpha 1,6 glucosidase enzymes, because in last step one glucose molecule has been remain in the position, so the second step, the alpha 1,6 glucosidase enzyme, they are responsible for break the glucose molecule, because that glucose molecule is bound with the chain with alpha 1,6 bond formation linkage. That bond has been cleaved by the same enzyme. It's a second step. So what's the thing is there, once it's cleaved, it's going to produce the free glucose molecule. So the remaining molecules, the glycogens, is again available for the action of phosphorylase. Same thing. So we know that the glycogen is having a various sub branches. So the transferase enzyme is going to transfer the glucose group, glycosyl unit, from sub branch to main branch. That means 1,6 bond to the linear part, but it's going to remain one glucose molecule in the same branch. That means 1,6 linkage bond. So that's the first step. In second step, the only one glucose molecule has been attached with the sub branch with 1,6 glycosidic bond. So that glucose molecule has been breakdown. That means that bond has been cleaved by the same enzyme as a step 2. Now the glucose molecules become free. So the same thing, the same manner, we know that the glycogen is having various branches is there. So one by one, the branches is going to cleave. It's going to produce the free glucose molecule. The third step. Now the glucose molecule is released. That means it's not a free glucose. That's a problem here. So the glycogen phosphorylase and the debranching enzyme is going to produce the glucose 1 phosphate. The first one is glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is going to act. The second one is transferase enzyme, second step. So at the end of these two steps, it's going to produce the glucose product, but it is not a free glucose. It's a format is called as glucose 1 phosphate. So it's not a free glucose. So in that step exactly, the glucose 1 phosphate is converted into free glucose. That reaction has been catalyzed by phosphoglucomutase enzyme. That enzyme is responsible for conversion of glucose 1 phosphate into glucose 6 phosphate. From the glucose 6 phosphate, it may enter into the glycolysis cycle also, because the glucose 6 phosphate means it's easily in glycolysis step, the glucose 6 phosphate is converted into the fructose 1 phosphate, 1 phosphate. So once it's enter into the glycolysis, the pathway is going to differ. But in glucose 6 phosphate, it's converted into the glucose in liver with the help of glucose 6 phosphatase enzyme. So it's an irreversible reaction. We know that in gluconeogenesis process, we have seen the same thing. From the conversion of glucose 6 phosphate to glucose, it's an irreversible step in glycolysis. That step has been bypassed by the phosphatase enzyme. That enzyme is going to catalyze the reaction. That means it's going to dephosphorylate the glucose 6 phosphate. So it's become free glucose. So it's now the glucose molecule is available. So it's going to produce, it's going to involve the energy production purpose. So the next one is a regulation of glycogenesis and glycogenolysis. Still now we know that what is glycogenesis and glycogenolysis, all those things we have seen in depth in pathway wise. The next one is, what are the regulators it's going to control, otherwise it's going to initiate the glycogenesis, otherwise initiate the glycogenolysis. What are the things is going to regulate these two pathways? So because the both the things is different mechanism. Once the excess amount of glucose is there, means it's going to convert, the glucose molecule is converted into the storage form, condensed form into glycogen. The storage glycogen, when you are under starvation condition, the stored glycogen is going to break down to produce more amount of glucose for energy production purpose. So it must be coordination is there. The glycogen synthesis and the glycogenolysis process must be coordination is there. So the regulation of glycogen synthesis and the degradation of glycogen, it's directly it's going to involve for maintain the blood glucose level. We just imagine when the blood glucose level is high, when the excess amount of glucose is there, means it's converted into glycogen. That means it's going to reduce the blood glucose level. The same manner, when you're having a low amount of blood glucose, hypoglycemic condition, that time the glycogen is going to break down, it's going to produce the glucose, so it's going to retain the sufficient blood glucose level. So this two things is very important, because it's two pathway, it's going to control the blood glucose level, otherwise it's going to fluctuate the blood glucose level. Glycogenesis and glycogenolysis. Glycogenesis and glycogenolysis are respectively controlled by enzymes, the glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase. Because in last sub in glycogenolysis, we have seen these are the two enzymes. Glycogen synthase enzyme, it's responsible for the synthesis of glycogen. Glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, it's responsible for breakdown of glycogen into glucose molecule. So these are the two enzymes, is act as a vital role to control the two pathways, these two pathways. So regulation of these enzymes, some of the things is directly regulate this enzyme by three mechanisms. One is allosteric regulation, hormonal regulation, and influence of calcium. These are the three things is it's directly is going to control these two enzymes. Which enzyme? Glycogen synthesis and glycogen phosphorylase enzymes. Apart from that, I said so many factors is going to regulate or is going to involve the glycogenesis and glycogenolysis. We know that last step also we have seen steroids, glucagon, insulin. These are the things are directly or indirectly is going to control these two pathways. So these two enzymes has been regulated by these three mechanism: allosteric regulation, hormonal regulation, and influence of calcium. So the first one is allosteric regulation. So you can see here, this is a glycogen. Glycogen is converted into glucose. That process is called as glycogenolysis. So the same thing, glucose is converted into the glycogen, means it is called as glycogenesis process. So for this process, the essential enzyme is glycogen synthase enzyme. For genolysis, glycogen phosphorylase enzyme is responsible. That thing we know that from the previous slides. So what are the things is going to regulate? You can see here, the glucose 6-phosphate, it's also it's involved in the glycogen synthesis process. Apart from that, same manner, the same glucose 6-phosphate, it's going to inhibit the process and the presence of ATP, liver glucose. So when the excess amount of glucose 6-phosphate is there, ATP is there, then glucose is there, means no need for production of glucose, because already existing amount glucose is there, energy also there, and glucose 6-phosphate, that means intermediate product also there. So these are the three things as what is it's a these are the three things as it's a glucose product. So it's already available. So that time the glycogen breakdown process is no mandatory. So these are the three things is going to inhibit the glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. Because of that mechanism, the glycogen is never breakdown into glucose molecule. Okay. Then in other side, you can see here in muscle, presence of excess amount of calcium ions and cyclic AMP, these are the things is going to promote the glycogen phosphorylase process. Because when your muscle is going to work out, when your muscle is going to working, that time it's release more amount of calcium ions, then cyclic AMP production also there, that thing is directly is going to promote the glucose production by from the glycogen by stimulate the glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. Okay, that's a allosteric regulation of glycogenolysis and glycogenesis. That's a first one. The second one is hormonal regulations. We already discussed that. We already seen hormonal factors. It acts as a regulator for the glycogen synthesis, glucocorticoids, glucagon, insulin. These are the things is going to regulate the glycogenesis process and the glycogenolysis process. What's happening exactly? We can see here, glucagon and epinephrine. That's mean adrenaline. These are the two things. It's going to increase the glucose level. That's the end point. You just imagine the glucagon is going to increase the blood glucose level. The adrenaline also is going to increase the glucose level, because whenever you're having a fight and flight condition, adrenaline pumping, your body is going to work out more. Your body is going to working fast. That time it's need glucose for met the glucose demand is going to the this mechanism. So the end thing is glucose is going to increase. That's a concept. So now what happened exactly? This glucagon and adrenaline is going to inhibit the glucogenesis process. That means glycogenesis process. And apart from that, it's going to inhibit the gluconeogenesis process also. But these are the two things is directly inhibit the glycogenesis. That means formation of glycogen. By how? Which mechanism? What is exactly going to happen? Means once these are the substance, glucagon or adrenaline is going to bind, means it's going to activate the adenine cyclase in plasma membrane. So it's going to activate the cyclic AMP. That cyclic AMP is going to activate the protein kinase, cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. So once this protein kinase is activated, it's going to dephosphorylate the ADP to ADP. So this is responsible for conversion of active glycogen synthesis into inactive glycogen synthesis. For simply, you can understand, once this receptor is going to, once the substance R is going to bound, means it's going to inactivate the glycogen synthesis. That's a thing. It's going to inactivate the glycogen synthesis by various intermediate steps. Adenine cyclase activated, cyclic AMP production, cyclic AMP mediated protein kinase. Cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase is going to activate. So it's going to inactivate the glycogen synthesis enzyme. We know that the glycogen synthesis enzyme is responsible for glycogenesis process. So that process totally stopped. That means more amount of glucose is available. That's a step. That's a second thing, hormonal regulation. In same thing, you can see here the same hormonal regulations, it's going to act on different pathway. The first one is it's going to inhibit the glycogenesis. The second one is it's going to promote the breakdown of glycogen into glucose 6-phosphate. I already say that in last slide itself, the glucagon adrenaline, it's directly is going to, at the end point, the glucagon and adrenaline is going to increase the blood glucose level. So what are the ways is there? What are the different possible ways there? One is it's going to inhibit the glycogenesis process. That means glucose conversion into glycogen. That step has been blocked, means the glucose is available as a free. The second step is it's going to promote the breakdown of glycogen. So the glycogen is going to break down, means what's happened? It's going to produce more amount of glucose. That is second step. So this picture is going to represent the that step. So the same thing in last slide, the same cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase is going to activate, means it's going to inactivate the glycogen synthase enzyme. But here the same thing, so once is the protein kinase, cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase is activate, means it's going to activate the phosphorylase kinase. That enzyme is responsible for the activation of glycogen phosphorylase. We know that the glycogen phosphorylase, it's responsible for breakdown of glycogen. So now the glycogen is going to break down, so it's going to release more amount of glucose. So at the end, glucose level is increase. So the third one is influence of calcium. So the effect of calcium ions also is involved the glycogenolysis process, because when the muscle is going to contract, when we are doing any physical work, continuous workout, so the calcium is going to released from the sacroplasmic reticulum. The calcium ions is going to released from the sacroplasmic reticulum. So that calcium ion is going to bind with camelidin pathway. That is called as calcium camelidin pathway. So it's going to modulate the protein. It's going to modulating the protein that is going to activate the phosphorylase kinase. So what's the thing? If it is phosphorylase kinase is activate, means what's happened? The same thing. Last we have seen the phosphorylase kinase is going to activate, means the glycogen is going to break down. So overall effect, the glycogen metabolism, that elevated glucagon or epinephrine level is increase the glycogen degradation, whereas elevated insulin is going to increase the glycogen synthesis. The overall calcium ions level and hormonal glucocorticoids level or glucagon or epinephrine level, so these are the things is going to increase the either glycogenolysis process, otherwise is going to decrease the glycogenesis process, and it's going to increase the glucose level. The same manner, if it is insulin is available, means it's going to increase the glycogen synthesis. That means it's going to decrease the glucose level. So it's convert the glucose into other product. That means other product maybe it's enter into lipogenesis pathway, otherwise glycogenesis pathway. The glucose is converted into either glycogen, otherwise lipids. So that's a overall regulations involved for the glycogenesis and glycogenolysis. So that's all. So here itself I can now end up the session. In next class we have seen some other concepts. Thank you.